And Masu Kaltuk?
Yeah?
You're under arrest for trespassing and the destruction of private property at the Silver Sky mining facilities. Turn around and hands behind your head.
I'm gonna need a minute.
Ma'am? Ma'am, I said turn around and hands behind your head.
She's 10 centimeters dilated. Contractions every 2 minutes. Shoot me, but I'm getting that baby out of her.
Is this a clinic?
It's a birthing center. The last one in the region. Do you want to arrest me for that too?
This week on Night Country, the investigation continues as we follow Navarro and Danvers through some new leads like headlamps piercing through the dark of the fifth day of night in Ennis, Alaska. Strange things continue to serve as mile markers on this journey into the dark heart of mystery on this season of True Detective. An orange tossed back from an icy shadow, a tale told by an unreliable narrator, dreams of spirals, a ghostly visage from beyond bringing Navarro a ghastly message. What new threads have been pulled this week? Let's cast our line into the frozen tundra and see what icy fish we might dredge up together. My name is Justin Carey. Thank you for joining me this week on Screen to Screen. Grab some coffee, turn on those headlamps, and let's see what we can find in the silky darkness of Ennis, Alaska, on this week's episode of True Detective Night Country. The investigation is on.
What do you want from me? Why don't you run from me? What are you wondering? What do you know? Why aren't you scared of me? Why do you...
All right, so here we are, episode 3 of Night Country. An interesting episode, you know. I was sort of expecting a little bit more this week, having just rewatched season 1 of True Detective. And I was thinking that, you know, this whole theme throughout the show of... Throughout the entire 4 seasons of the show, of this idea that, you know, like everything is just repeated over and over again, right? Like time is a flat circle. And is the show really trying to lean into this theme of like everything repeats? And I think it is. I think it is. And I was curious as to how far they were going to go with that structurally. Were we going to get an episode 3 of Night Country that was structurally almost exactly the same as episode 3 of True Detective season 1. If you recall, in True Detective season 1, episode 3, that was the episode where Cole and Hart sort of they close in on one of the Tuttle schools and encounter the guy on the lawnmower, who ends up being a very important figure later on in the show. So I was speculating that perhaps in this episode, maybe we would encounter someone who was a very important character in the overall mystery, but we wouldn't know that that person was a very important character in the overall mystery. And that could still be a possibility. So there could, you know, if we are really thinking about this idea of this sort of time as a flat circle and there's a structural resonance on this show, then this new character that we encounter, this Oliver Takak? Maybe an important character, maybe not, but we'll see. We'll get to him in a minute. Anyway, this is an interesting episode. We get the mystery continues to unfold, and there are some really interesting sort of structural connections with season 1 of True Detective in this episode. Now, not you know, there are some interesting, I didn't mention this in my last episode of this podcast because I didn't really put it together until I did my own searching, but the Travis Cole character that we hear about in episode 2 ends up is the father of Rust Cole from season 1, the Matthew McConaughey's character in season 1 of True Detective. And so we you know, this ghost that we see that Rose follows out into the snow that points the detectives to the bodies of the Salal men scientists is the father of Rust Cole from season 1. And so there are these really interesting connections to be made between season 4 and season 1. And I would even argue that there are some interesting connections to be made here between season 2 and season 4 as well, especially with a lot of the father-son stuff. But anyway, this season begins with a flashback, and we see sort of what we maybe assume to be the first meeting of Anne and Evangeline, Anne and Navarro. And Navarro is called out to arrest this Anne the woman that is murdered later that Navarro is investigating, and she's called out to this this building, and there's these screams coming from inside, and Navarro investigates, and it turns out to be a birthing center. It turns out to be the place where the indigenous women are gathering to give birth. And we learn later in the episode that stillborn babies are a major issue in the community here. And this has a lot to do with the poisoning of the water from the factory. And we hear Liz Danvers talk, you know, later, sort of as the more and more of the political aspect of the show comes to light, that this factory, this production facility that is this town, is like being protected, because that's what makes this town go, is this facility, this production. The economy of this town rests on this factory. But this factory is poisoning the land. It's poisoning the people. It's causing a lot of harm to a lot of the people. And here we are, you know, again, back to this theme of, like, you know, the money, the power, the politics, it all is this vicious cycle that hurts the people involved in it, right? And this is a common theme in the show. I mean, this is in all the seasons, right? It's like the way that the people that have the power and the money and the influence are the ones running the show. And the people like underneath all of that are the ones that are just getting ground up in the meat grinder of all of that. And so we're hearing and seeing that theme again. And so Anne is kind of a hero in this opening scene. She delivers this baby who is not breathing when it's delivered, and she gives it CPR, and the baby lives. And then even after all that, she sort of asks Navarro not to arrest her for 10 minutes so that she can give birth to this baby. And then after the baby is born and she takes care of it, she then just offers herself up to Navarro to say, okay, now you can arrest me now. And then we flash forward to now, fifth day of night. We're on December 22nd. So it looks like we're kind of, I don't know, it's interesting that we're kind of building up here to like the Christmas holiday. There's a lot of sort of Christmas imagery on the show. It'll be interesting to see how that plays in as we go forward. You know, the sort of idea of like, there's a lot of religion on this show, right? We have a conversation later with Liz and Navarro in a car. They're driving. You know, this is a theme in True Detective as well. The detective's driving in a car and talking. And Liz and Navarro have this conversation about religion. And Liz is very incredulous in this conversation. You know, Navarro is being very serious and says, she says that I pray. And Navarro sort of opening up about her spirituality, and Liz kind of just makes fun of her about it. So it'll be interesting to see sort of how religion and spirituality come into play in this show later, especially considering that we're coming up to this Christmas holiday, themes of rebirth on this show, a lot of imagery of birth, of like life and death, and especially in this episode, beginning with a birth, ending with a death. A lot of themes of motherhood on this episode, a lot of themes of like mother child in this show. You know, those sort of mother daughter relationships on this show, or sibling relationships on this show, a lot of family stuff on this show. So it's all of those sorts of themes are very tangible, I think, here. So all of that is really interesting themes to kind of pay attention to, I think. So anyway, we're on the fifth day of night here, and this sort of they've decided to kind of Hank, the cop that's kind of always being a thorn in the side of Liz, he's the dad of Peter, he's not a great guy, he's put together this sort of manhunt group to sort of hunt down Raymond Clark, who, asterisk, in the first episode of this podcast, I kept calling Clarkson, like the guy from Top Gear, but his name is Clark, Raymond Clark, the scientist who was in a relationship with Anne, who got the spiral tattoo after being obsessed with Anne's spiral tattoo, and he's on the loose. So he's out there somewhere, and they're trying to hunt him down, and Hank has just decided to ask citizens to help him with this manhunt. So there's a bunch of like just dudes with like camo gear and rifles just like running around. And one of these dudes drops some fruit on the ground. Really interesting scene here, because one of the pieces of fruit that he drops on the ground is an orange. Traditionally, ever since The Godfather, oranges have sort of represented in a lot of shows and televisions and film, they've represented death. The scene when Don Corleone is gunned down in the street, he's carrying oranges and there's oranges everywhere. And so oranges have come to symbolize like death or a harbinger of death. And so it's interesting that that Navarro picks up an orange here and sort of puts it in her pocket. So as soon as I saw this orange, I thought, oh, someone's going to die. Like there's going to be death in this episode. This is a harbinger of death. Oranges typically symbolize death. And then as she's walking through the snow in this later scene, it's very interesting because I don't know if you noticed, but like I sort of was goofing on headlamps in my little intro speech there on this episode, but her headlamp, the light from her headlamp looked odd to me in the scene when she later, where she's sort of walking out in the snow. We get a lot of scenes in this episode of Navarro just kind of walking out in the snow, like out in the ice. And she talks about that in this episode. She sort of has this moment with Liz where she's like sort of opens up to Liz and says, do you ever just wish or do you ever dream that you could just like walk out? Like you ever get a feeling where you just wanted to head out or just go out or just walk out? And we see Navarro doing this. And it makes me curious, like, are these scenes real or is this like an image of Navarro's fantasy of herself just like letting go? Kind of in the way that Cole talks about letting go in season one, just like letting go of yourself, right? And sort of coming to terms with the fact that yourself isn't really yourself and you don't really know what yourself actually is and that there is no self. Sort of that embracing of nihilism that Rust Cole is so interested in season one. Anyway, there's a weird shimmeriness to her headlamp in that scene. It's odd. It's very dreamlike. It's very strange. And in that scene, she sort of goes into her pocket of her parka, pulls out this orange that she picked up earlier, and she sort of angrily throws it as hard as she can into the darkness. And then, like, a moment later, it, like, rolls back right at her foot as if someone or something sort of just, like, gave it back to her. Really interesting moment. Does it symbolize like her rejection of death, but then an acceptance that death must come back to you? Is it some sort of entity? Is it a ghost? Is it a supernatural form or entity sort of interacting with her? Is it symbolism? Who knows? We don't really know. But I just wanted to point that out because I thought that the orange thing in this episode was really interesting. So yeah, moving on from there, we hear that one of the doctors, the one that survived, the scientist Anders, is still in a coma. We'll get back to him later. There's literally a moment where Danvers says she hates everyone, so I thought that was pretty telling. She has a moment with Peter in the police station. She literally says, "I hate everybody," which is accurate. And then we have a really interesting moment here, where Peter wants to know why Danvers and Navarro hate each other. And Danvers decides to tell him the story of the last case that she worked on with Navarro. And here we have this sort of an echo of what happened in season one with Cole and Hart.
Only one bedtime story. It's a murder-suicide. William Wheeler. He's a bad, bad motherfucker. Sexual assault. Armed robbery. Assault and battery. He was in and out a bunch. The last time he came out, he took up with an 18-year-old girl. And beat her. Hard. Sent her to the hospital twice. Broken arm, smashed jaw, some other things. He went to his place a bunch of times, but she wouldn't report him. His story was always the same. Ah, she was drunk, officer. Fell down the stairs, officer. We knew how that was gonna end. But there was nothing we could do. Then we got the call.
And so this, we see this playing out. The audience sees this we watch this. We watch Navarro and Liz as she's telling the story. We watch them do this. And it turns out the story she is telling Peter is not what actually happened. This is exactly the same thing that happens in season one when Cole and Hart tell the story of Reginald Ledoux and what happened there, right? And so this is the unreliable narrator thing sort of coming back again, right? So that we don't actually see... we don't see Liz and Navarro kill William Wheeler here, but we see them arrive at the scene, and it is not a murder-suicide. William Wheeler is still alive, and he is sneering and smiling at them, very proud of the murder of this young woman that he's just committed. And we get the sense that Liz and Navarro most likely just extracted justice upon him in that moment, in the same way that Marty Hart did to Reginald Ledoux in that scene from season one. So... again, it's that theme of like, it's what Rust was talking about in season one. Like, we're just going to do these things over and over and over again. So we get this sort of season one connection here with this William Wheeler story. And then Liz and Navarro start to put together a sort of a timeline. They look at all the evidence they've collected and sort of get this, they sort of piece together some of the timeline, and they discover that there's some hair dye on one of the photos, and that leads them to this hairdresser that might have some information for them. And so they go and speak to this hairdresser, and she does have some information for them, a lot actually. And it's a new lead for them in the case. This hairdresser who knew Annie and knew a guy that worked at the research station who left before the scientists went out onto the ice and died. And they speak to her, and she gives them some good information about the spiral tattoo. Really interesting, actually. Some stuff here about the spiral tattoo, that Annie was dreaming about this spiral image, and she got the tattoo because of these dreams that she was having, and then the dreams stopped after she got the tattoo. Excuse me. The hairdresser turns them on to this guy named Oliver Tagak, and they want to go find him. But he is an indigenous person. He's not in any of the computer systems. They're having some hard time tracking him down. And so it's up to Navarro to figure out where he is. It also comes to light here that this hairdresser did speak to a police officer when Annie was murdered. And it turns out that police officer was Hank Pryor. And he buried the case. He didn't report it, and he just silenced it. And Navarro was super pissed about this. And she confronts him, and Liz confronts him, and they have this very tense moment right in front of the bodies in the ice skating rink. And tensions are really high, and they all yell at each other, and there are threats made. Liz ends up throwing some coffee in Hank's face. Everybody's mad at one another. But it's a lot of like sword brandishing. Nothing really happens there. They just yell at one another, and everybody just kind of like walks away. So more bad behavior, and no, with impunity, really. Like, no one's really, nothing's really happening to anyone. It's a theme here. It's like they're very isolated in this town, right? There's really no, like, when the authority in the town are the ones doing the bad things, there's no one holding them accountable, right? And so, you know, that's just how it is. It's tough, right? And so from here, Navarro visits her friend, Kavik, out in this little fishing shed. Now, they show this fishing shed in the intro, which is interesting to me. And I don't know, I mentioned my theory before about season three, sort of, or episode three, like giving us, like showing us someone important to the case, but like not letting us know that, right? Like, they did this in season one. And so is this guy Kavik, this guy that's like Navarro's friend, who's such a nice guy and like, you know, he's like the good guy. Is he the bad guy, really? I'm putting that out there as a theory. You can let me know what your thoughts are on that. Like, is this guy part of the problem? Maybe. I'm gonna float that idea. You know, maybe we're not supposed to look too closely at him because he's so nice and he's just sitting out there in his little ice fishing shed. But who knows? All right. I'm gonna float that. And we get a little bit of information about Navarro's mother, who was killed, and her murderer was never found. Navarro's father was not a good person, hurt her mom, and her mom left and was murdered and was never found. That's going to be important for the end of the episode. And then Lee, Liz's stepdaughter, they have some words. You know, Lee is sort of rebelling. She's kind of trying to find her own identity. She's trying to sort of make an identity for herself, kind of figure out who she is. And they just continue to have a very tense relationship. I kind of understand why Liz doesn't want her daughter to kind of get involved with the people she's involved with, because Liz is looking at case files of indigenous women who are constantly being murdered. Because they are protesting what this corporation is doing to the town. So she's sitting there all day looking at these case files of dead indigenous women with these facial tattoos. And there's her daughter, like, behaving and you know, doing the same sorts of things and going down those same pathways. And so Liz is reacting in a very, like, in that kind of way, like, don't be like that. Don't do those things. But the more she does that, the more she's pushing her daughter down that same path. And so it's this loop of sort of self-harm. And so we get this really interesting moment when Navarro then leaves the fishing shed. She's walking away and she sees someone, like a child, off in the distance, like maybe a ghost, maybe a memory, who knows. She starts to run after this kid and she slips and falls and bangs her head on the ice. And then she's sort of, I don't know, passed out, dreaming, not sure, but she's back in, like, in the desert, maybe in, like, a war zone. But she's not in Alaska anymore. She's somewhere. And then there's this, like, hand that reaches out to her, potentially the same hand that reached over on Liz's shoulder when she was asleep. And if you look closely, this child is wearing pajamas. And there's a word on the pajamas that's backwards. And that word is dreamer. Backwards. Interesting. So, like, a reflection, right? Which is cool. And I believe the child says, "Get my mommy." And I think the kid's holding that stuffed polar bear toy. So I think this is the same kid that is sort of haunting Liz's dreams as well. So this is interesting, because now this figure is appearing in a vision or a dream or something with Navarro as well. And I don't know, there's this, you know, this idea of running out, right? Like, they keep this phrasing keeps coming back in this episode, ran out. Like, she ran out. She's run out. Navarro gets a call that her sister has ran. She just ran out. Like, people are running out in this episode. They're going off. They're running away. They've gone out somewhere. So her sister has just run out into the middle of nowhere, and she's just, like, sitting in a boat in the middle of nowhere, like, freezing to death. So Navarro goes and finds her sister. Rescues her, sort of. She's struggling too. The theme here is that no one is sleeping, right? Like, it's like the middle of the night and no one is able to sleep. Everyone's just, like, really struggling. They're up till all hours of the night. Nobody can get any good sleep. It's like, really, like, everyone's suffering from, like, insomnia. This whole, like, not having a regulated sleep cycle is really taking its toll on people, I think, in this part of the world. And we're sort of seeing some of the effects of that. Peter comes home to his family, wakes everybody up, disrupts their sleep. That's not going well. A lot of tension there. And then we sort of get the end of the episode. They go and they find this Oliver Tagak, and they sort of, he's very angry with them. He doesn't want to talk to them at all. They sort of, Danvers and Navarro barge into his house, and confront him, and he doesn't want to talk to them.
You're standing on traditional Nipak territory. Unless you have an order, if you take one step in, I'll blow your brains out.
I hear you. So, if I go in the state records, this property is your land? It's under your name, Mr. Tagak?
You want to come and see the deed, lady? You. What's your name?
I'm A.T. Evangeline Navarro.
No, Kenya Atkin. Who are you?
I just told you.
Oh, you forgot, didn't you?
We're here to talk about Annie Kautok.
Annie?
So this meeting does not go well, and they don't get much information here from Oliver. And they're called back quickly to the hospital because another situation is brewing. And this sort of brings us to the very sort of end climax of this episode, where one of the scientists from the research station, Dr. Anders, is awake. And he's pretty much on the brink of death. His body is sort of failing, but he's speaking and he's saying some weird stuff. And it's this very creepy, almost verging on horror film sort of esque scene. They're really going into the sort of horror in this season, which is kind of cool. It's kind of neat. It's kind of a different direction for the show. But it's a very sort of horror scene. The guy is like multiple amputations. He's just like on the brink of death. He's making these horrible sounds. They go see him in this hospital room. And he's saying some really creepy stuff, like, we woke her up, she's out there, she's in the ice, we woke her, and then he kind of passes out, and then Liz is sort of abruptly called away because the sort of civilian hunters that Hank Pryor had hired to help with the search for Raymond Clark have gotten into fights with the police officers out in the lobby of the hospital, and so all hell is sort of breaking loose. Navarro stays back with Anders. And then we just get this really sort of super, super creepy, like, exorcist ending.
Raise your hands.
Hello, Evangeline. Your mother says hello. She's waiting for you.
This show, it's kind of wild. I mean, there's a lot of weird stuff happening here in Ennis, Alaska. We got ghosts, we got possessions, we got dreams, we got all sorts of wild things happening, and we're only on episode 3. So we're really I think far off into like horror land here. And I don't know, is it Liz is very much of the mindset that like the magic stuff, the horror stuff, the ghost stuff is all BS. Like there's a logical, rational explanation for everything. And, you know, but Evangeline seems to be having a lot of interesting and strange experiences. Rose seems to be having a lot of interesting, strange experiences. A lot of the characters seem to be having these sorts of experiences. And it's very much Liz being the sort of naysayer to all of these things. So I'm really curious where this season is going to go. You know, are we going to get a sort of like, you know, the factory was just poisoning us the whole time and everyone was tripping because the water was making us all crazy? Or is it going to be like what Rose was talking about, how Ennis is like coming apart at the seams and like the world really is sort of like some kind of creeping cosmic horror has seeped into the world, you know, and that's what's sort of like poisoning the world. That's why the world in season 2 and season 3 is so tragic and why everything is so bad, is because like all of this poison physically, metaphorically, is like finding its way into the world. We see this theme in Twin Peaks season 3 too. Like there's just something wrong. There's something wrong with the world. Some crack, some fissure opened up somewhere, sometime, someplace, and it just hasn't been put right. And so I'm really curious. So yeah, that was episode 3. A lot of cool stuff. I'm really excited to see where this show goes. I will admit that I never did get around to season 2 until yesterday. I watched the whole season yesterday, and I really actually liked season 2 a lot. It was very Lynchian. It reminded me a lot of Mulholland Drive. So if you haven't watched season 2 of True Detective, I highly recommend going back and checking it out. A lot of cool themes You might not like it because it was a lot different than season one, but I am planning to also go back and rewatch season three this week so I can have it all fresh in my mind as I make my way through the dark cold of season four. Thank you so much for joining me this week for my little breakdown discussion of episode three. I hope you're enjoying Screen to Screen with me as we make our way through True Detective Night Country. If you have any questions or you want to leave me a message, feel free. But thank you so much for joining me on this journey. My name is Justin Carey, and as always, the investigation is on.
What do you want from me? Why don't you run from me? What are you wondering? What do you know? Why aren't you scared of me? Why